And that's the correct answer. All right, so let's actually go through that exercise and just derive how we do that, because it's not so bad in two dimensions, and it generalizes to higher dimensions as well.
Okay.
So it turns out that we can use calculus to do this. I am not going to step through the two-variable example for reasons that I am embarrassed to say, but I am going to show you a different example. So imagine that what we're trying to do is that we've got a bunch of data points, and we're trying to find the best constant function, right? So the best function that has the form, the value of the function for any given x is always the same constant c. All right. So if our data looks like this, we've got a bunch of x's and a bunch of y's, then what we're going to do is we're going to say for any given value of c, any given constant, we can have an error. What's the error going to be? The error is going to be the sum over all the data points of the squared difference between that constant that we chose and what the actual yi value is. So that's
Michael?
Really these differences here. Yes, Charles?
Can I ask you a question?
Sure.
Why are we doing sum of squared errors?
Ah, there's many different error functions, and sometimes call a related concept called the loss function. There's lots of different ones that could work. You could do the absolute error. You could do the squared error. You can do various kinds of squashed errors where, you know, the errors count different depending on how much deviation there is. It turns out that this one is particularly well behaved because of this reason that I'm explaining now, that that because this error function is smooth as a function of the constant c, we can use calculus to actually find the minimum error value. But there's lots of other things that could work, and they actually do find utility in various different machine learning settings.
Okay.
So just now using the chain rule, if we want to find how does this error function output change as a function of the input c, we can take the derivative of this sum, you know, bring the 2 over times this, times the derivative of the inside, which is negative 1 in this case. And now this gives us a nice smooth function saying what the change in the error is as a function of c. And if we want to find the minimum, what do we have to do to this quantity?
You set it equal to 0, because that's what I remember from calculus.
That's right. So in particular, if the error, you know, the error function is this nice smooth thing, the derivative is negative and then 0 and then positive. When it hits 0, that's when the thing has bottomed out. All right, so now we just need to solve this equation for c. So we have one equation and one unknown. All right, so that gets us this. But this quantity, it's just the constant added to itself n times. So it's n times c. If we move that to the other side, we get n times c. N is the number of data points, as you recall, is the sum of the yi's. We divide through by n, and what do we see? So what is it, Charles?
The best constant is the average of all your y's.
Right, it's the mean. The mean comes back. Right, so in the case of finding the best constant here, we just have to average the y's together, and that gets us the thing that minimizes the squared error. So squared error is this really nice thing because it tends to bring things like mean back into the picture. It's really very convenient. It generalizes to higher order functions here. Not higher order functions, but more variables like lines. Sorry. Lines that have some non-constant slope. By doing the same kind of process, and things actually work out really nicely.